on the podcast.
Yes, I am. Good to be back, boys. And
I'm surprised you showed up without your crew.
I don't need them. Well, not that I don't need them. Just that we do exist, you know, individually as well. No, you guys invited me along. And so I decided to come along alone. So how is everybody? How are you treating my baby?
Oh, it was all the podcast you made. The podcast that you abandoned. This is still
you ran
baby.
Out for a pack of cigarettes on.
Yeah.
You
went to the shops to get milk. And it's been about 4 months now.
Guys, you say that as if, you know, I didn't invent this thing and can do with it whatever the hell I want. I mean, the very first episode, I didn't even have a co-host. It was just Duke Cannon as I interviewed Nathan North. You came in after, Pat. You came after.
Don't call me Pat.
Kairn.
Well, someone had to pick up your slack.
Yeah. I feel like it's actually been better because you've not.
I feel like it's improved over the last couple of months.
You've not, you know, abandoned your principles.
No,
or, you know,
no.
Like that. At least I thought I knew you.
No, you just abandoned the standard of quality that we had on this podcast, but that's neither here nor there, gentlemen.
I thought the quality's done pretty well for we've improved it. Are you alright, Paddy? You know, but
yeah, you seem a bit tense. Everything okay? Can I get you a cool beverage?
I'm good.
Can I get you some kind of snack? Yeah.
What you could have done was stay out of our match at the last show, because we were about to hashtag powerbomb Tom Atlas through that mat until you decided to get involved.
No idea what you're talking about.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Getting up in the stadium, talking to the ref, you know.
Having a conversation while having a pint. Yeah. Jesus, are you going to hold everything against me?
Yeah. I think you're a bit worried that the two boys that never had a match with each other before were about to, you know, ruin your sort of coming out party as a wee trio.
Well, if you were as good as you think you are, no matter what adversity came your way, you would have probably still won. Yeah. But you didn't, did you?
Very much in the gaslighting
duty. Yeah. Mm. I'm just kind of trying to...
Gaslighting isn't real. You're just mental, Patrick. Okay?
Here we go again. Sorry. I've got your back. I'm here for you.
Thank you. Yeah. You might have to leave this one because... Yeah. There's history here and I'm still...
Someone's angry.
Yes, I am.
Someone's angry.
But you know what? We'll talk about it later, but I'm going to get an opportunity to take that anger out on you, Duke.
Mm. Fair. Fair. So, I mean, you've already dropped protocol because this is the point where someone says, welcome to the FCW podcast.
Yeah, so now he wants to be like the host and do the bits again.
Well, someone's got to pick up the slack here because, we're about 3 minutes in and no one's done the introduction. Come on, chop chop, boys. Where's this professionalism?
So, Kairn, you go. You go for it. You lead. What are we doing? What is this?
This month we've got two shows to go over.
Yep.
And we have the guest... unfortunately back, Duke Cannon.
Great to be back, folks! Great to be back!
Is it Duke Cannon anymore? Is it the one and only, whatever that means?
It's Duke.
Yeah.
To use.
Okay. To us. Okay.
Well, to everyone, it's Duke. That's all that you need to know.
Okay.
Well, speaking of things that we sort of need to know, usually what we do is we try and get to know our guest a bit more. Something that Duke actually invented on this podcast, and he wants to stick to protocol, so let's go for it. This will be quite usually a sort of a fun-filled segment, but I don't think this is going to be a fun-filled podcast.
We'll get through this.
So, Duke, you're world-famous Five Questions of Doom.
Oh, we're not doing that.
Alright, okay. Who's not sticking to protocol now?
Again, you forget, this is my podcast. This is my segment that I invented. And I think it's actually an interesting thing. Do you know why I invented the Five Questions of Doom?
Well, was it not meant to be we get to know our guest a bit more and have a bit of pleb banter and sort of break the ice and get into the podcast before we talk about the show? That's what it was meant to be.
But you're absolutely...
I have a funny feeling that you've got an ulterior motive, seems to be what you're all about.
No, not at all. You hit the nail on the head when you said about getting to know our guests better. And what better way than through some quickfire interview questions? But the thing is that why we need to get to know each other better. You see, I invented those questions so that I could find out a little bit more about any future opponents, obstacles in the way of my plans, various miscreants and people that might just give me a bit of a bad time, because I don't know about yous, but I've always been a firm believer in know your enemy. So with all this in mind, because these interview questions were about extracting information from people, influences on their wrestling and ideas that they might have further down the line, why would I indulge you two with my influences so that you could look into me to find out what I might do? No, okay, come on, this isn't a rhetorical question, guys. Answer it.
That seems a bit far-fetched. Like, what's your favourite pay-per-view got to do with what you're planning to do in the ring?
Simple. Your favourite pay-per-view includes maybe your favourite wrestlers, your favourite matches, ideas that you might not have came up with before that you've taken influence from. All on this stacked card of however many matches that you can look through and pick out the little things that you want to add. Look at the people who inspire you. Take inspiration from them. So then I can go in and I can see what inspires you so that I can destroy you.
You're there, Paddy.
This is like the realization that sort of the last almost a year, you've just been like playing me like a fiddle. I don't like it. Because I invited you into my home, I introduced you to my family, who really liked you, and
you do have a lovely family, yeah. You really do.
And you've just turned into this, well, that's the thing, you've not even turned into this piece of work, you've clearly been this piece of work the whole time. One thing that I've just realised, Caleb Douglas, do you remember who the first three guests were on this podcast?
Oh, I was wondering how long it was going to take someone to notice this.
Because I'm speaking of like... How was Duke been doing this the whole time? So I'll refresh your memory for those of you who don't remember. Mm. First guest on the podcast, apart from Nathan North, who, as we all know, Duke stabbed in the back.
Oh, well, we'll get to Nathan. We will get to Nathan.
So when no I worry. First joined the crew, first guest we had on the first episode proper was Sebastian Asher. Second guest we had on was Tom Atlas, I believe. Spike Tierney. I couldn't remember the order. And it was Tom Atlas third.
Here we go.
So you, clearly you guys have been plotting for some time.
Yes.
Yeah, so if you're not going to get into... And you know what? He's not going to do your hot sauce bit, is he? Because he clearly doesn't like fun anymore.
Oh, no, that's more just because I've got raging IBS. Yeah. Okay. Or do I? Am I feeding you information, gentlemen? Oh, this is going to be a long and fun episode.
You didn't get that just yourself, did you?
Maybe.
Have fun when you go home.
Yeah, just...
Anyway, if you're not going to tell us your five questions of doom, we need to... I think you can give us a bit more as to what you've actually been doing in secret for this past year, or however long it's been. Who knows how long it's been going on? Because I know that you're the kind of guy that would like to plant little seeds like this, and you clearly have done with... Because you were the one that said, let's get Sebastian, let's get... Spike and let's get Tom.
Mm-hmm. He was very adamant
right. About that he wanted them on before anyone else. Mm. So how long have you been brewing this cabal?
Yes. Well, you are right. It would be a very boring episode if I came in and just talked about the card and things like that. I think it's time to at least peel back a little bit of the layer as to what has been going on. Now, don't get me wrong. I understand that there is this idea that I've been deceiving everyone. And don't get me wrong. Like, I totally get it because to a certain extent I have. But don't think that this means that I've lied about everything about me. I do. I genuinely do love Warhammer 40,000. I do play tabletop role-playing games. Shout out to my guys in the Overdogs. That's a reference for a very select group of people.
I researched Warhammer references for him to make him happy.
I just had tumbleweed.
Yeah. Yeah. And like, I've just realised that time was wasted as well. Yeah. Anyway, sorry.
Wasted more of your valuable time. Yeah.
But the thing about games that I've picked up the most and I've carried forward in my life is things like, you never reveal your strategy straight away. You keep your cards close to your chest, and probably most importantly, you always stay at least one step ahead of your opponents. Now, if we're going to talk about where this all started, going to have to go back a little bit. Probably to a couple of years ago at a DAPW show at the Queen's Hotel. Now, I believe that one of you was in attendance there, and I believe that the other one said that the match that I was in was one of the reasons why you started training as a wrestler.
Correct, yeah. I'll not deny that. I don't care you were there.
I was there. It was one of the first FCW shows I actually ever saw live. Admit that.
Yes, yes it was.
I saw it later on Empire and I thought, that looks like a fun place to train. These guys are great in the ring. I'll never deny how good you are, Duke.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And don't
as a wrestler.
As a wrestler, yeah. As a horrible person now. Or it's maybe happy the whole time.
Well, it seems like you've been playing games since the start. You've been playing games.
I'm being very careful with my language because I'm aware of.
And I don't appreciate that. But I'll let you continue.
That's no problem. But as to the folks listening who might not know the context, the four people in this match were Sebastian Asher, Tom Atlas, Spike Tierney, and myself. Now, remind me, because I believe it was you that was there, Kairn?
Yes, I was.
What was the purpose of that match?
It was a contenders match for the FCW Junior Heavyweight title, I'm sure.
Precisely. Mm-hmm. A contendership match for the Junior Heavyweight title. Now, yep. Something that I completely agree with. I agree that we should have to fight to earn our chance in order to go into the ring and go for the gold. I mean, I like to think that I did that myself. Well, no, not myself. Nathan North was there as well when we got the tag team champion belts from Redgate. We worked our way up. The amount of ass kickings that I took by myself, because I was abandoned left, right, and centre. At one point, even being forced to defend those belts by myself. And it was only through my own cunning that I managed to get around that. Work ethic is imperative in this industry. But then we noticed something. I believe it was actually, I think it might have been Spike that pointed it out, that after our number one contendership match, there wasn't really any others. Everyone else just kind of got stuff handed to them. They did. They got to come into that ring. They didn't have to fight past anyone else. They didn't have to struggle. They didn't have to grow as people. No. They could just come in and have a shot. Let's have a look at the last person who got a shot at the junior heavyweight title. And that was Jay Robin. Now, I'll admit, Jay has made leaps and bounds as a wrestler. He has. He's done very, very well. But let's look at what he did in order to get actually both shots at the junior heavyweight title. Because the first one, I believe that was at Name Mercy at the Ardler Complex, and that was a triple threat between Spike Tierney, myself, and Jay Robin. And not 15 minutes before, Jay Robin was thrown out of a trainee battle royale. And I even said it there. He can get thrown out of that and then get a shot at the big title. He can get a shot at that belt. Is that fair? Let's look at what led to his next attempt at getting the junior heavyweight title. He had a match against Dickie Divers, which he lost. Before that, he had a match against ADM. And he lost. Now, I'm not saying that he did not put up a fight. I'm not saying that he went down easy. No, not at all. He did put up a lot of fight. And he stepped up to a mark that very few other people would. but he lost. And J. Robin is just one symptom in a long, long line of people getting ahead of themselves, let's say. Getting ideas of grandeur, getting ideas that they can put themselves above their station. And sometimes you just need someone to show you where your place is. Someone has to maintain the pecking order. Have I ever told you guys about the pecking order?
No, I don't think
so. Well, here's the new pecking order that's going to be going about. There is everyone at FCW, there's the dirt, there's the worms that crawl in the dirt, there is your lovely dog down here's Stool, there is Stevie Wizard, and then there is me, Sebastian, Tom, and Spike. And the reason that we're putting ourselves up there is not because we think that we're better than everyone else. It's because as long as there's no one there to install order, chaos will reign. And we can't have that. We've seen what chaos does to, say, the women's division, when everyone was going about and kicking asses and the belt was getting, like, launched left, right, and centre, until Serena Rose, who, again, I'm starting to see in a bit of a different light nowadays, I'm not going to lie, until she came in and installed order to show people that you can't just run amok. So that's
sorry, can I jump in here?
Certainly.
Because you're talking absolute bollocks.
Okay.
You're saying that you have somehow warped this, done this mental gymnastics to try and say that you're here to stop the chaos reigning, when in fact you definitely are the chaos.
No. See, this is part of the misconception. See, everyone seems to think that we are coming in here and that we're running amok and that we are ruining fair city wrestling.
You literally said you would ruin every main event.
Yeah.
Going forward. And but if you didn't get a shot. Speaking about not deserving a shot, you tried to, like, stage some sort of coup to get yourself into the main event at the last show.
FCW is the pot, and you are the wooden spoon.
You've just done this mad reframing of events.
No.
You've walked a lot of it in your own mind here.
No, listen.
Looking for
listen.
Stuff that isn't there.
You say that we are sort of dropping ourselves in the pot. No. Fair City Wrestling at the moment, it's a bone that's been broken. It's a bone that's been broken and hasn't been set properly. So as a result, it's become malformed. It's become dangerous to have. It could look really bad in the future if the things that are happening right now continue to happen. But sometimes, in order to fix a bone, you have to break it again so that you can set it properly. That is merely what we are doing. Sometimes you need to have that little bit of insurgency in order to install order. Look at any major revolution within the past 500 years and you will see exactly where I'm coming from. Sometimes you need to have that level of upheaval before change can properly happen. And we don't want to have the upheaval. We don't want to cause all this chaos. If we could come in peacefully and maintain the order the way that we want and the way that we need, everything would be fine. But we know for a fact that we can't. We know for a fact that we cannot. And do you know why that is?
I'm sure you're going to tell us.
Oh, I am going to tell you. The reason that we can't is because people don't like to see change. It's simple. As humans, we don't like to see that change. We don't like to see when things, even if things start getting warped and we can see that it's getting bad, we still just like the familiarity of it. It's like a frog being boiled in a pot slowly over time. All we're doing is just jumping in and jump-starting the correction of that. All we are doing.
I know you're wanting to say something, Kim. What is that?
You just lost me with all these analogies. Yeah. I didn't really realise you were a medical profession or a historian. Please do not take what Duke Cannon says as logistical medical advice.
So what does FCW look like in this sort of utopia that you seem to be going towards or trying to carve out in your own image? Where are we in a year's time?
Now that would be telling. I mean, as I said before,
Well, that's why we're asking.
Well, I know that's why you're asking, and that would be telling if I told you. But as I said before, the one thing that I've learned is to keep your cards close to your chest. So I think that might be enough for use for just now. Don't worry. There's going to be plenty more getting revealed. There's going to be plenty more things in the months to come. But you're just going to have to wait and see. Don't want to spoil the surprise too quickly, do we?
You do know this is a podcast and not a game of poker.
And it's that mentality as to why you guys lost at the last FCW show.
I didn't even talk about the show.
No, Kairn, listen to me.
Oh, God.
Listen to me, Kairn. You say that it's not a game of poker. You say that it's not a game to have in any way, shape, or form. This entire industry is a goddamn game. No, think about it. If you've got a chance to put yourself above someone else to get into a show, do you not? Is that not giving yourself an advantage over other people? Other people are trying to play fair by working hard, by training, by postering, by trying to do everything that you can. Everyone's got the same 24 hours of the day, but some people can get that little bit of a leg up. Some people can get that little bit of an advantage over others. And the thing is, we're trying to play against each other as well. We'll maybe try and convince someone, oh no, you shouldn't go into that match. Oh, tell you what, put in me in that match, put in that guy, put in this. This entire industry is filled with backstabbing and wheeling and dealing. All I'm doing is saying that it's actually there, yet somehow I'm the bad guy?
You're not saying it's actually there as well. You're doing everything you're supposedly against.
I never said that.
An eye for an eye. Eventually everyone goes blind.
Kairn, I never said that I was against it. I'm just saying that it's there. And I'm just partaking in it. And I'm just being open about it as well. Would you rather that I come in and lie to your face and say, no, you can totally trust me. You can trust everything
that's,
I say.
That's what's been happening in the last
year.
That's exactly the last year.
You're a massive hypocrite.
And now
you're blind to that.
No, I'm not blind to it. I'm now telling you that you can't. I'm now revealing the fact that you can't. I'm giving you two the most important lesson that you can learn in this industry. Trust no one. I mean, who's to say that there isn't going to be a time when one of you turns on the other guy?
That's nonsense.
Nonsense? If you asked Patryk a year ago if I would turn on him, he would have probably said the same thing. It's funny that you're the one that says nonsense. You got something to hide?
Gaslighting joke again. Just ignore him.
Yeah. I'm
really
just
regretting inviting you into my house here.
Well, he wasn't getting back in mine. Yeah. So, yeah.
Well, I'm not regretting it because I've got to see this cute little dog here. Hey, buddy. How's it going?
She's on blood watch.
Aw, look at her. She's sweet. I like her.
So we're not going to get much else out of them.
No.
So how about we move on to plugging the first of two shows that we are here to promote.
Let's
for FCW and then the newly named Dundee Angus and Pro Wrestling. But we'll get onto that later. We'll get onto the
report. That is currently in the hands of Sebastian Asher. Let's acknowledge our champion there.
I mean, the company is. The belt is. The company is not.
Oh, yeah, of course. I was referring to it.
Don't get too ahead of yourself. I know that Sebastian likes to sort of claim that he has things when he doesn't have them, really. But, you know.
But he does have the DAPW belt. Yeah. And we should acknowledge that, shouldn't we?
Which he won fairly and squarely,
yes,
didn't he?
Well, yeah. Well.
Anyway, before we get dragged down by that again, we have our next FCW Empire show coming to us from the Empire Zone. I'm trying my best to get excited about this, but the company's not helping. We've got...
Oh, you've got me booked.
I know you do.
Come on.
Yeah. So we've got FCW coming to us next from the Telekin show on the 5th of April.
Yes.
Which, of course, is WrestleMania weekend. So
it is.
If there's any weekend to come out and watch live wrestling, why not do it on Friday, April 5th?
Yeah.
To kick off a wonderful weekend of wrestling. So let's go through the card, Kairn and Duke. I'll kick us off, why not? And I'll just prove why Duke's been talking a lot of havering, or been havering a lot in this podcast so far.
Yeah.
He talks about people not having to earn title shots, and he was really annoyed that he had to do it in a fatal four-way. So should we talk about a Fatal 4-Way number one contenders match?
Yes. Yes, let's do it.
Wow, the first one in how long?
So.
Oh, no answer there. I can tell you. I can tell you.
Was it since your one?
It was since my one, yes.
Did someone just sound a little bitter? Yeah.
Not really bitter. I'm just happy that Fair City Wrestling finally sees my way of things. See, order is starting to be restored already. It's like nature is healing again. It's great, isn't it?
One thing I am looking forward to about this match is that All Elite Wrestling, for lack of a better term, bottled the Meat Madness match.
They did, didn't they? They gave up on that.
So, if AEW aren't going to do it, silly Tony. If AEW aren't going to do it, then FCW sure the hell are.
Yeah.
Because we are having essentially our own Meat Madness match, a Fatal 4-Way number one contenders match for the contendership of the FCW Heavyweight Championship.
Mm-hmm.
We have got ADM versus Hunter Samson versus former two-time champion Caleb Valhalla versus Bruiser Brad Evans, who you know a little bit about, Duke.
I do.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. What are we thinking for this match?
Oh, let's let Duke go away.
Because you've not really spoken, you've not spoken at all, really, since then.
Yeah.
Since Bruiser Brad Evans cost you the
I forgot about that.
Because I've been wanting to genuinely was trying to reach out to you and find out, like, what you were feeling after this. And then you obviously answered that with a chair shot to the back of Nathan North. And I will not shy away from the fact that I still maintain, if it wasn't for Bruiser Brad Evans, you would still be tag team champion with Nathan North, and who knows where we would be right now. So he's been essentially the catalyst for change in FCW indirectly, Bruiser Brad.
He has indeed. He's certainly something that me and Nathan did not take into account. But also his arrival kind of revealed a few things to me about Nathan. And one thing led to another. And hey, I'm now flying solo. I'm like the George Michael of Wham. I'm the successful one. And he's now off somewhere. But no, you're right, right. Bruiser Brad Evans is a big catalyst in all the changes that have happened. But what I also say is that with Brad, he is a fantastic wrestler. He is part of a very strong unit. A very, very strong unit. And he kind of reminds me of myself a little bit, and the whole, you know, keeping people guessing, never revealing your hands too early, because we did not see that coming. I can say that much.
I think we've pinched in the earth here.
No, you haven't, because reeling it back to where we were before. No. Bruiser Brad, in the context of his singles match, absolutely fantastic there. In his match with, in his appearance during our title defense, you know, he did pretty well. But that doesn't necessarily mean that he can step into a ring with three other very big, very scary men and still be able to stand a chance. Now, that's not going to be through lack of trying. I can say that much. He certainly put a number on Nathan North, which made it really easy to, hit that nail on the head. But when you've got somebody such as, say, Caleb Valhalla, he's won that belt twice. And you can see both times that he has put every single thing into it. If there's a man that I respect, it's him. And also, I just want to point out that, like, just because I do these things to certain people doesn't mean I have a lack of respect for anyone. I just know what we'll have to do to get ahead. But going back to this match, as we're saying, talking about doing what you must to get ahead, you have people there who have been more nefarious. You've got Bruiser Brad Evans and ADM, but you've also got Caleb Valhalla, who has won everything and earned everything through might, through strength, through perseverance, through growth, through struggle. And Hunter Samson, from what I've seen on his times at Fair City Wrestling, as well as a couple of other times outside of that.
Yeah, the newly crowned hardest man in Fife.
Newly crowned hardest man
in Fife. I think the wild card in this match, for sure.
Hunter Samson?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think people are probably sleeping on him. I think, obviously, people in SW are more familiar on with Caleb, with ADM, and to a lesser extent, maybe Bruiser Brad as well, because he's still fairly new to the company as well. But if I had to call this match, I'm thinking ADM and Caleb are going to be too obsessed with each other, like they have been for, well, give or take a month or two, forgive me if I'm wrong. It feels like about 6 months. Maybe it is that, but if it's not, it feels like it. Feels like they've been at it forever.
Oh, yeah.
ADM. This all started when, I believe, when ADM challenged for the title when Caleb was champion.
Yeah.
Caleb retained. ADM's not been able to get past it since. He's been chasing him ever since. This might actually be the first time they've actually competed against each other since then. Again, correct me if I'm wrong in the comments or on my socials. Mm-hmm. But we've been we've been keeping them apart in the company. Until of course, they had that special referee match last month as well, which just ended in like chaos backstage. Commissioner had to step in and make this match. I think it's going to come down to Hunter Samson and Bruiser Brad, because I think ADM and Caleb are just going to be so obsessed with each other that they're going to take each other out. And I think it's going to be if Hunter can continue his momentum. I have some feeling Hunter's going to do it. Really do.
I mean, honestly, I can't disagree with you on that one. I definitely think that the animosity between ADM and Caleb will probably be the downfall of both. Yeah. You can't make these things personal, can we? No. You have to keep a level head when you're in there. And remember that there are two other opponents that want this just as much as you and the guy that you want to beat the hell out of want it as well. So, while I can definitely see where you're coming from with Caleb Valhalla and ADM doing it, I don't want to give him the credit, because as a wrestler, he's fantastic. As a human being, I hate him with every single ounce of poison and bile within my system for things unrelated to what we've discussed before. But Bruiser Brad being the newest in here, I mean, fair enough, Hunter Samson is very new as well, but knowing what Bruiser Brad is willing to do in order to win,
which is anything,
which is literally anything, it's whether the other people in the ring are going to be willing to go to those lengths as well.
Mm-hmm.
And well, I could see ADM possibly doing that. I definitely could. Mm-hmm. I think he has the ruthlessness that you need in order to probably put yourselves above your opponents. Caleb Valhalla, fantastic wrestler, got a lot of strength. It's whether he can lose that bit of humanity, let the mask slip a little bit so that he can destroy everything else in that ring. And Hunter Samson, again, he's new, he's done quite well so far, and it'll be interesting to see where things go from there. But honestly, with everything that we've spoken about, with the animosity between Caleb and ADM, and with Hunter Samson's, at least so far, a little bit more straight-laced approach to wrestling, might have to go with Bruiser Brad on this one, because I can't really see anyone else having the sort of level of planning and ruthlessness that he does.
What you said to Kel?
I could just see you really struggled saying that there. You really struggled to say that.
But I said it.
Yeah.
Again.
I think he's going to win it as well. And I hope he does. And I hope it rubs you the wrong way. That's what I really hope.
It won't.
It will. Look at you. You're stewing in it right now.
Well. Typically, he wins a contendership doesn't mean that he's going to win the belt. But so, what is the next match?
And then what may happen?
On the card.
Oh, but then what may happen?
Can I let you pick?
Let's go with Ewan G. Mackey and J. Robin taking on your fine self and Sebastian Asher.
Oh, yay!
Neo Paradigm reunion
part
here.
Deux.
Yeah, Neo Paradigm part deux. Who'd have thought that, like, we'd be seeing the Neo Paradigm together in this light? Not me. To quote somebody in FCW's phrase, did not have this on my bingo card. No. But here we are. The world moves in mysterious ways.
What are you talking about? Do you not... Okay, I feel like I'm going crazy. So let's...
Why do I think we're going to have some crazy reframing here again? Crazy.
Again, disclaimer, Duke Cannon is not a historian. Please do not take anything he says as fact.
Okay, well, you can fact check this yourself. How about we look back to the episode where J. Robin was on? And
I know exactly what you're going to say, because I was there.
Oh, yeah, that's good. Well, for anyone who might have missed that episode, when we asked him the five questions of Doom, one of them being if you could tag with anyone, living or dead, fictional or non-fictional, who would it be? He said Ewan G. Mackie. Now, this was post-Neo Paradigm as well.
It was. This is after Jay had walked out on him.
Exactly. Jay respects Ewan. Jay knows what Ewan is capable of and has learned a lot from it. And to be honest, Ewan has taught us an awful lot. He taught me that I can be really good at insulting the crowd while he's reeling from one of the most devastating power bombs he's ever taken in his life. Ewan's always there to push us harder and make us even better wrestlers than we already are. Now, I could see this coming because, well, I'd be up Ewan, then we'd be up Jay. So, of course, almost as if we planned it, they are teaming up. And, I'm not going to say that we calculated this one to the nth degree. But I'm not saying that, am I?
But is that smart, considering their history and the fact that, like, they know each other so well? They've teamed together before. They've trained together for years.
They've done. And you, as I said, Ewan has taught us all. Their bond has also already been broken once. Now, I don't know if you have experienced this, but you might someday. When that bond gets broken, something changes in you as a person. It does. It makes you think differently. It makes you act differently. It makes you approach life in a different kind of way. Now, I remember the bond that they had before and everything that they were willing to do to win. But that's not there anymore, is it? No, it's all goody two-shoes. It's all sunshine and lollipops and rainbows and all these things that I always think about when we're together or whatever the song goes like. But they've lost that edge. They have. Because if they had that edge, you and Jimaki would have kicked my ass when you went up against me. If they still had that edge, J. Robin wouldn't have fallen for something so blindingly obvious. Hell, the start of that match with Spike, I said that we were going to come out. So that's why I think that J. and Ewan, as good as they are wrestlers, as great as they are as wrestlers, they don't have what it takes anymore. They don't. And that's why Sebastian and myself are going to win. That's simply it. I mean, I could go into how we're going to win, but that'd be telling, wouldn't it? That would be telling.
what rubbish. You know what I mean?
Is that all you have to ever say, Kairn?
Oh, you just babble and babble on, man. This is just... Are you getting fed up? I'm getting quite fed up.
Okay, right. Enlighten me with what you have to observe from this match. Come on.
From this match? I just think you talk a lot of crap right now.
I think you've, like... You think you've manoeuvred them into a trap, but... Again, I'll go back to it. They're the experienced team here. You've never, to my knowledge, tagged with Sebastian. Am I wrong? That's got to play some sort of factor here. You can do all the sparring, you can do all the training.
He doesn't gel well in a team.
You can get, I mean, yeah, he's got a history of not playing well with others.
Even in our match last month, he wasn't gelling well with Tom.
He was actually dragging Tom Atlas around the ring to tag in and out. I don't think that would go down well with you if he was trying to do that to you. give a little trouble in paradise at the back at the, I don't know, do you have a, like a base or a lair or something? Like a laboratory? A cave?
I mean,
a dungeon?
I wouldn't,
where do you guys hang out?
I feel like it's under a railway bridge.
Yeah. Down by the docks.
Yeah.
I mean, no, I wouldn't mind a laboratory. That would be kind of cool. Yeah. But also, as we were saying before, you're right. Sebastian was dragging Tom about. He was dragging him about left, right, center to tag himself in. And it's, you know, it's a very interesting development, isn't it? It shows that
his last tag team partner as well.
Oh no, I know what he did with his last tag team partner.
I'm guessing that was your call, was it?
Bang on the money. Do you not think that for a second them breaking up wasn't part of the plan? Do you not think for a second that Tom leaving Ewan was part of the plan?
Seriously, none of these boys think for themselves.
You're the puppet master. You misunderstand me. You misunderstand me. I'm not saying I'm some kind of leader. I'm not some messianic cult person. No. I'm an ideas guy. And I like to bounce back and forth with people. Now, we all sat down and we discussed this. We set out our timeline of what we want to achieve and when. But obviously, there's things that have to happen first, isn't there? There's teams that have to be broken up. There's bridges that have to be burned. And it all has to be done in plain sight, doesn't it? Everyone saw what happened. Everyone saw when Sebastian turned on Omar. Everyone saw when Tom turned on Ewan. Everyone saw when I turned on Nathan. And everyone saw when Spike turned on the audience. So let me ask you, with all this planning and preparation and everything that we've got, do you not think that maybe Sebastian dragging Tom about was there to give you the impression that he doesn't play well with others?
No, we know he doesn't play well with others.
You're
not falling into this trap of you talking a lot of nonsense. He doesn't play well with others. We know it. It's part and parcel of who he is.
Play well with me? Play well with me when we had him on the podcast and I told him to punch me right in the face. You were there. You believed it, Patrick. You're currently just staring into my soul. You were there. You believed it. Didn't you, Patrick? I saw you in that video. I saw you tending to my unconscious body with all the protection of the great friend that you are. Had to make it look real, didn't we?
Trying to get a rise out of
you. It's working.
Don't fall for it.
Yeah, don't fall for it, Patrick.
You're the better man.
I'm just havering. I'm just talking a load of rubbish.
As usual.
Absolute nonsense.
At least he's finally admitting something.
At least you said it.
So, as I was saying, yeah. Me, Sebastian, we're going to let them. I'm pretty confident that that's what is going to happen.
I guess we'll find out.
Yeah.
Oh, do you not have your own predictions?
I mean, I think it's quite pointless because we'll just be here for to listen to you go around in circles.
Yeah, and talk. No, just talk utter crap.
Yeah. You've talked enough about yourself, mate. Next match. You know what? I will give you the courtesy of picking the next match because I will stick to protocol. You know, because you love that so much.
I love protocol, mate. Love it. Right. Who do we pick? Since I mentioned her before, how about we go for a title match? How about we speak about Serena Rose versus Brody Adler?
Brody Adler's cashing in her game changer briefcase. Serena's
nobody run now.
Duke touched on it earlier. Like we've seen this change in Serena Rose. And Duke will remember as well. I used to sit on this podcast and sort of talk about how I always thought Serena Rose is too cocky for her own good and like she's going to slip up eventually, but she convinced me because she just kept winning. All she does is win. And now she's, ever since Brody won that case, she's had this sort of newfound fear, almost like doubt in herself with Brody. Like it's like I think she's worried that like this might be the one hurdle she can't overcome.
Mm-hmm.
She beat Brody before, but it was in a fatal four-way, I think, when she actually regained her title to To the best of my knowledge, I don't think she's beat Brody one on one. So is that fear of the unknown? I don't know. But like, it's very strange to see Serena Rose doubting herself, which is clearly what she's doing, because this isn't, like I said, it's not something I've seen before. So I'll open that up to you two.
Still have to take into consideration that Serena Rose could pull some sort of trick.
Well, we saw that last month, didn't we, when it looked like Brody was going to cash in. Yep.
She's always got something up her sleeve, so that's something we do have to take into account. Yeah.
Well, I actually didn't even know who that was that Serena Rose had with her. You've been around this company longer than me, Duke, so you could probably fill in.
Yes, I believe that was Debbie Keitel. I haven't seen her in a while. Good to see that she's doing good. Yeah, it's a...
She can swing a chair.
Oh, she can certainly swing a chair. And you know me, I love someone who can swing a chair.
I didn't really say that.
But it's kind of going back to what we were saying before about always being one step ahead. Even if Serena has had this little crack in her armour, she's still one step ahead at all times. I mean, look at it this way. Did you see the get-up that Serena Rose was wearing at the last show in order to hide from Brody? She was sitting in the front row dressed like Inspector Gadget, and Brody Adler still fell for it. I don't think Serena's got anything to worry about here. I think, if anything, Brody should still be worried about Serena, because even though she's cashed in, that doesn't necessarily mean that she is going to win. Like, the Sword of Damocles that is the Game Changer briefcase does not guarantee victory.
Thanks for stealing my line.
Oh, I didn't know that was your line.
Yeah, you didn't know because you went away for months, but anyway.
I do apologise for that. Would you like to say the line?
No, I'm fine.
You sure? Yeah. Okay. So, as I was saying, the Sword of Damocles that is the Game Changer briefcase does not guarantee victory. Not in any way, shape, or form. Now, yes, Brody has cashed in. Brody still has to win, though.
True. Something that nobody's ever done against Serena Rose.
And the thing is, if Serena is always going to be one step ahead, does that mean that this might actually be Brody's last shot at the belt? If she loses, she has to wait for another opportunity, or wait for the next Rumble, or next opportunity to get the Game Changer briefcase back.
So what you're saying is you wouldn't have called the shot ahead of time like Brody did. I feel that's what you're getting at. So, and a lot of people would agree with you, I think.
Yes. I think that Brody is confident.
Yeah, which is to be admired.
Definitely to be admired, but maybe confident to a fault.
Mm.
And the fact that when you're dealing with someone who is as forward-thinking as Serena Rose, you can't really afford to slip up. Now, that's really what this is going to come down to. Is Brody cashing in this early, her slipping up?
The worry for me is we get a repeat of what happened last month. Picture this, Kairn, right? This is one thing I'd be worried about for Brody. They're two and they're in the ring. Match starts. Brody just gets blindsided by a chair again.
Yeah.
She wins by disqualification. Her shot's gone.
I'll give Serena some credit. She's always came up with a different plan.
You don't think she'll go to the well again? Or at least not at the start of the match.
Maybe not at the start of the match, but she always knows, again, as I said, Brody has been hit with a chair once. Brody is now expecting to be hit with a chair.
That's true.
She's probably expecting interference.
Exactly. Yeah. So Serena has to think around that. It's the eternal game of four-dimensional chess that we play when we're in the ring.
You like this, Kairn. Duke will like this as well.
Yeah.
What would you do, hypothetically?
Oh, what would I do?
And you're in Serena Rose's shoes.
If I was in Serena Rose's shoes.
Yes, in those very big shoes that she kicks people in the face with.
Kicks them right in the face with.
Yes.
Can we see you in the kitchen?
What?
Chick kick.
What would I do? I would look through every episode of FCW Empire and look at what hasn't been done yet. Look at what has not been employed in order to try and win a match. Because the thing is, we have a whole plethora of material that we can go back and watch, and we can go back and research our opponents and things like that. But nobody seems to do that, do they? Nobody seems to actually think about what their opponents are good at or not, or what other people have tried in the past or not.
That's you assuming.
I mean, that is me assuming.
You know what they say about that.
They make an ass out of you and me.
But mainly you.
Yeah. Have you also caught on to what I just did there?
No.
Thank you
that
for...
That doesn't grammatically make sense.
Thank you for giving me an insight in how you think.
Mmm. You opened up.
Yeah.
You got there, but you opened up a bit.
You sly dog. You've got me monologuing. Okay. Okay. See, Patryk, this is what I was talking about. This is what I was talking about, doing everything that you can to win. Maybe I judged you far too harshly before. But we'll get to that later. No, no, no.
I'm not just a pretty face, Jim.
No, you're not. No, no, no. But yeah, so I stick to what I said. I would look to see everything that has been done before in the history of Fair City Wrestling and think outside the box a little bit. And I'm pretty sure that Serena is smart enough to do that as well.
Yeah, she's like, she's a student of the game.
Yeah.
She will watch. I have no, I think you're spot on, to be honest. I think she all joking aside and all that, I think she will study all the tape that is out there on Brody Adler.
She'll come prepared. She'll definitely come prepared.
But I know Brody will be doing the same.
Yeah.
She's been waiting for the shot for
quite a while.
Probably about a year. I think it was just over a year since she lost the title.
Mm-hmm.
She's been on this sort of year of redemption, and maybe she sees it to try and climb that mountain again.
Mm-hmm.
And she's hopefully going to reach the summit.
Yeah, I agree. There's not really much else to add to this match. I think we're all in quite
similar camps. Yeah. Come back right to myself then. We spoke about one hunter earlier on. Let's speak about another one. We've got a pal from down at Dundee and Angus Pro Wrestling.
Oh, we do?
Making his singles debut in FCW.
Ooh.
He's wrestled on Dundee and Angus Pro Wrestling shows before.
Mm-hmm.
This is a first time wrestling in a singles match in Perth. Got Hunter Redwood.
Oh. Who has Hunter Redwood got?
Hunter Redwood has got one half of the SCW Tag Team Champions, the inspirational Ryan Riley.
Whoa.
And, I mean, if it wasn't enough meat for you in that Fatal 4-Way match, then we've got a side order here, because these are two big lads who are going to bring
side order up beef.
Yeah. For as good as Ryan Riley is as a tag team, he's a tag team champion. He's also a tremendous singles wrestler.
Yes.
And Hunter is one of the up and coming singles guys we've got coming out of Dapdup. So
Hunter's a strong boy. Yeah. A real strong boy.
It's going to be very interesting to see what he can do against Ryan, who obviously, as we know, has been. For all the experience he's got on Hunter, he's primarily been a tag team wrestler recently. So how's he going to try and adapt his game to take on Hunter, who's been focused on solo competition? So is that going to be a leveler?
Well, Chip, you've took on Ryan, so you'd have a bit more experience here.
I do indeed. And if there's one thing that I can say about Ryan Riley, it's that so many people underestimate him. A lot of people... Unfortunately, a lot of people sometimes just see him as, you know, the guy who's in the foundation of the future. But he is so much more than that.
Yeah, he's not just Zach Dynamite's partner.
Like, do you remember when he had the match against Caleb Valhalla?
Yes.
Yes.
Do you remember how fast he moved? How high he could jump?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He can, like, for a guy his size, to move as quickly as he does.
Very impressive.
It's insane. Yeah.
I always knew how good he was, but remember when he came down, him and Zach, to the seminar, back at Dapdub. Well, you weren't there, were you?
No, I wasn't there.
Well, I was there, and I knew he was good, but I didn't realize how good he was until you actually roll around with him in a training session.
I'm sure this is when I was injured, so that's what I missed.
It was actually I misremembered. Yeah, you were also not there.
I think
you make a habit of that. But yeah.
What's that supposed to mean?
You know exactly what it means.
No. If we're going to get into this, why don't you bring it up? So you don't have a problem there.
Well, you kind of just... This is the ironic thing, and I don't want to keep coming back to this, but I have my suspicions of what you did to Nathan, the reasons why. And you touched on it earlier on. You claimed that Nathan abandoned you several times. Which, you know what? And I didn't say it on the podcast, I wanted to let you say it yourself. Because... I think I did know you quite well, or I do know you quite well. And I know that that rubbed you up the wrong way. The Tayport saga, for example, Nathan wasn't there to have you back. You did a very similar thing that I ended up doing with you, trying to reach out and get in contact with him, you blanked him. That's why it really rubbed me up the wrong way as well, that when somebody did... how do I say this without just getting angry? You did the thing that you were angry with Nathan for doing, so you're no better than him. Why would you do something that made you angry? Why are you just passing that down the line?
You know what? You know, I can accept that to a certain degree. And... yeah, and you know what, I can accept that.
We had a lot of things planned. We had so much planned for this podcast. We had things like going to these training sessions together planned. We socialised outside of wrestling as well. And then you just went dark. You did what you didn't like your former partner doing to you.
You're right. You're right. I did. And for that, I will, you know what, I'll be honest. I am sorry. I know that yous maybe can't trust me or yous are wary of me. That's 100% acceptable with everything that I've presented so far. But I will say that I am sorry for abandoning you. I am. The big difference is, though, is that Nathan's abandonment of me was a lot more selfish than I feel that it was a lot more... Look, I understand he had a lot of personal issues. When they started coming out, I was fair. I was by his side. I was at his back. I was like, I'm gonna do what I can for this company, for us as a team. But then it started becoming about things like bookings in other companies. Companies where he didn't hold a belt. Then it became, after a while, it just started to feel like he was just not having his heart in it. Which I can get to a certain extent. I mean, I was starting to get a bit disheartened at the fact that I was breaking my back to carry the team that we had.
I knew you were, because you were telling me this.
You could see it as well. Let's not beat around the bush here. You could see everything that I was doing to make this work. But it just kept happening. And I knew what the eventual outcome would be. It would be that situation with me and Nathan in the ring and me on the floor. Me with a chair in their back. Me eating the canvas as he walks out to do whatever he wants. All I did was head him off the pass. And you're right. I did go dark. I went silent. I didn't tell anybody what I was doing, where I was. And I understand that that was worrying, because you were just showing concern. And I appreciate that. I appreciate that so much. But the thing is, Nathan went dark for himself. I went dark for this company. I went dark because, as I said before, I can't reveal everything straight away.
I think a few would disagree with that statement there.
No?
Seems like you've done it for yourself. Seems like because what happened to you, you think it's all right to do it to Patryk. And you don't care. An apology, I don't believe it. I think it's all rubbish.
Well, that's just like your opinion, Kairn.
I'm not trying to make this about me as well, sorry. But this was always going to be this kind of episode. Everyone knows, like, that, well, the history indirectly now between the three of us is, like, growing all the time. And I'm not, again, so apologies to Hunter Redwood as well. Let's get back to his match.
Yes, let's.
Yeah, we know there's a lot of dirty laundry that's been needed to air between myself and Duke. So.
Yes.
But let's not detract from what a big achievement this is for Hunter as well, to find himself onto the main roster now.
What a big guy.
He is a big guy.
A big boy.
And the big thing, I think, for this match is, can he hit that sky high on Ryan Riley? Because I think if he does, we could be in for what the pundits would call an upset.
Or is Ryan Riley prepared for if he does get hit with it, how he counter it?
True.
These are all things that we need to consider for this match? You would say something, Duke?
I would definitely say that all things considered, again, I don't like giving credit to someone who's cost me something, as I have done before, but again, I think the underestimation a lot of us have about Ryan Riley could end up sort of being the downfall of Hunter Redwood in a lot of ways. Again, Hunter is good. He is really good. Hell, why do you think when he went for the DAPW belt, certain things happened?
Well, you didn't think Sebastian could get it done on his own, clearly.
No.
Myself and Kenneth to stop you and Tom from interfering.
The same with our tag match. You thought they couldn't keep it on their own, that you had to interfere. It's kind of a recurring theme we're starting to notice here.
I have the feeling that Ryan Riley will want to prove that he can do this on his own.
Mm.
Because there is that asterisk attached to their tag team title win. It's like, do they need to, the three of them, to get the job done? Or can they get it done two on two, or in this case, in a one on one match? So Ryan Riley's got something to prove, despite being a title holder here. Because it would be awfully embarrassing for the tag team champion to lose to the rookie on his first match, no? So there's pressure on Ryan as well. It's a massive opportunity for Hunter, but, you know, Ryan...
Hunter's got that motivation behind him. He's got that, this is my first match, I'm on as a singles mate.
Yeah.
I make my debut.
And what a statement it would be.
Yeah.
Hunter's walking potential. Like,
defeating one half of the tag team champions.
What a statement. Surely that puts you in line for a title contendership of some sort.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah, he's already been screwed out of one championship. So, good luck to you, mate. And I'm sorry, I said, I'll say again, Hunter, I'm sorry I got a bit distracted there, but I think anyone that was clicking on this podcast today knew that something like that was going to happen at some point. So
I knew the decorum that was coming into it.
I apologise.
I am Team Redwood as well for this match.
Again, I'm going for wild cards in this match. I'm going for wild cards named Hunter. I'm going for Hunter Redwood.
Yeah.
You know what? I'm not going to pick someone for this match. Because you do make a good point about Hunter. He does have mounds and mounds of potential. And we will be watching his career with great interest. So I'm not going to actually back a horse at this point. Again, Ryan Riley has the experience and he's shown that he can be a great singles wrestler. Hunter Redwood has the drive, has everything behind them to want it, to want to go further in this industry. So it could be anyone's game. I know that's a bit of a cop-out answer, that is fair, but I think it'll be interesting to see what happens afterwards.
Definitely.
Yeah. Shall we go on to the next match?
We've got two matches to go.
So I think we'll go with someone else making their single FCW debut.
Mm-hmm.
And the other half of the tag team champions, Zach Dynamite, and pretty boy Sam McMillan.
My, somebody really likes booking them foundation boys, don't they?
Really biting the nerve with you into your...
Nope, just... not at all. Let's carry on with the match. So,
another match, another wild card from... in this case, the APW again. Mm-hmm. We talked about walking potential. Pretty Boy Sam's another one of them. He was one of the guys that was along at the school with yourself when I first started. You guys have been there for a while. Sam had to take a wee bit of a break, but since he's come back, Christ.
Leaps and bounds.
Oh my God.
Absolute leaps and bounds. He almost eliminated you.
Yeah, yeah.
In the Rumble.
He did almost eliminate me. No, he did. He did eliminate me, actually.
He eliminated you both.
Did that a little bit much later
on.
Oh,
well, yes.
Yeah, no. He did, he's got a really...
Took me out.
He's got a really hard kick to him, which I think you know all about, Kim.
Yeah. But I'm pretty
sure
that boot...
Took him right in the face like a champ.
I'm pretty sure that boot had Duke written on it. It was coming for you, and you panicked.
I'm surprised that you can read.
Hey, don't make fun of my dyslexia. That's not fun.
Well, I mean... If the shoe fits... can just go for it. But yeah,
you mean if the shoe tiffs?
You are funny, not just funny looking. But no, as I was saying, Sam McMillan does actually have a lot of potential. I mean, like, it takes a lot from takes a lot for anyone to get me out of the ring and break my stride. And he managed to do it. And especially when he's going up against one of Scottish wrestling's best kept secrets in Zach Dynamite. I see so many people out there claiming to be the best, claiming to be, you know, the star of every card, deserving to be in every single main event. The thing about Zach Dynamite is that Zach Dynamite could go in there with one of the best in the world, and he can have one of the best matches ever. Zach Dynamite can also go in with someone such as Sam, fresh-faced, greenhorns, rookie, and still have an absolutely blinding match as well. Zach treats every single one of his opponents, maybe not with respect, but at least with reverence. He looks at them. He studies what they do. Doesn't matter how new they are. Doesn't matter how long they've been doing it. He studies every single thing that they do so that he can beat them. I respect Zach so much.
If there's a Mount Rushmore of Scottish wrestling right now, of like say the top four guys, he's always going to be there.
Yeah,
he's that good.
Yeah,
and he is one of them. He'll tell you that, but like he doesn't need to because everyone else will tell you for him. You know,
And he's one of the few wrestlers where, you know, other like there's a lot of wrestlers out there where other people go out to bat for them and say, oh, this person's fantastic, oh, it's amazing, and it's just hot air.
Yeah,
it's literally just hot air.
Yeah,
it's just people trying to blow up their friends, and you can see the mediocrity as soon as they step out from the curtain to a fanfare of nothing.
Zach's got the championships and he's got the stellar matches in his back pocket to back any of those claims up, or any of the claims that other people make about him. That's on. If I'm honest, that's why I worry for Pretty Boy.
It's a challenge he's got.
It's
a big uphill challenge.
It's a mountain.
Yeah.
It's a mountain.
I mean, Zach also put Tom Atlas in his place a while ago.
Yeah.
Did he not take, put Sebastian as well, if I'm mistaken? And,
I can't actually remember. But I mean, you could pick anyone in Scottish wrestling and Zach Dynamite's.
I thought you were going to say they put Sebastian in his place.
I mean,
you're struggling with this one, Paddy. I know you are. We're getting that.
But I mean, I think it is actually fair to say that losing to Zach Dynamite is like not being as good a piano player as Mozart.
Yeah.
Mm.
It's like not being able to paint as well as Van Gogh. It's not a dishonor. It's not a bad thing. It stings. Defeat always stings.
Mm-hmm.
But when you've got someone as good as Zach Dynamite, then it stings a little bit less.
Again, though, like with Hunter and Ryan, Sam and Zach, what if he beat Zach Dynamite?
What if he climbs the mountain?
And his, yeah, what if he, like Darby Allin on Mount Everest, what if he climbs that mountain?
He plants that Pretty Boy flag right at the top.
Harry Styles ringing around the Empire Zone. Zach Dynamite, one of the best wrestlers in Scotland, lying flat on his back, Pretty Boy on his debut. What a statement that would be.
To be fair, if that happened, I would say that all bets are off for the future of FCW, because that is...
Do I throw a spanner in your work?
Are you guys...
No.
Do you guys have felt if Zach gets hit with that boot, you know, he's got gunpowder in those boots, man.
Yeah.
I mean, if Sam McMillan beats Zach Dynamite, as I would say, that is a statement. But that's an upheaval as well.
Yeah.
Like, for all intents and purposes...
Paradigm shift if that happens.
Oh, yeah. Sorry.
Changing of the gods, is the same.
But it's kind of... It also comes back to the idea that up until now, everything is in order because everything makes sense. And it makes sense that Zach Dynamite is one of the best wrestlers in Scottish wrestling. If Sam McMillan comes in and beats him first try, that's not just an upset for FCW, that's an upset for the entire scene. That's an upset for every single wrestler in this country.
In the world.
In the world, even. That's a statement. That is powerful. Hell!
It'd be like, it's like 1-2-3 Kid beating Razor Ramon. It's that level.
I mean, hell, I'll tell you what, if Sam McMillan does win that, who knows? There might be somebody coming to scout them. You never know. But I digress. No. When it comes to this match, my brain and my heart both say Zach. They do. They absolutely do. But that doesn't mean that I wouldn't go absolutely wild if Sam won this. This doesn't mean that I wouldn't be going straight back to the drawing board to come up with some new ideas and some new plans if Sam won this. Because again, it's more than just a victory. It's a statement. It's a revolution. And if that revolution comes, it means a lot for all of us.
Absolutely.
I'm Viva La Sam.
Oh, Viva La Pretty Boy.
You know what? Actually, you know what? Screw it. I've given the foundation their credit. I've given them their credit despite the fact of how duplicitous they are. I'm going to be with you guys. I'm going to say Team Sam.
Viva La Sam.
It's what we want to happen.
Yes.
That is what I want to happen. I want to see this victory happen. So much. Mm.
So we've got one more match to talk about for FCW.
Okay.
For the Empire show. Now, as one thing we always point out as well on these cards, is that obviously the card is subject to change, yes, etc. Get your tickets at ticketsource.co.uk,
yep, /FCW
or on the FCW website. We have a championship match to talk about.
Okay.
We have Dickie Divers defending his title.
Against?
We don't know. What? That's the thing, we still don't know. At the time of this recording, we've not been told who it could be. Could it be the winner of the Contenders match? Who knows? Could it be someone not on the card that's not being announced? Who knows? Could it be bloody, I don't know, anyone?
Could it be? Henry, the mild mannered janitor?
Yeah. Pick a wrestler, any wrestler. We don't know.
Yeah.
So obviously, there's not so much we can say about this, but what we've been told is that Dickie Divers is defending his FCW championship against
him. Well, by logical sense, I would think it would be maybe someone from the Fatal 4-Way.
But then
the winner.
But they've wrestled once that night. But maybe that's what Divers wants.
That's a challenge.
That sounds exactly like the kind of thing that Dickie Davis would do. It is. Like, don't get wrong. If there's someone who is duplicitous in this company, it is Dickie It is.
Strings to pull.
Again, if you want to find out who it is, turn up on the night.
Yep.
Yeah.
I'll say no more about it just now. So we move on to Saturday.
To the Dundee show.
Saturday night's alright for fighting.
No. We're getting ahead of ourselves.
Actually, no, you're right enough, Duke. Yeah. Saturday afternoon,
we do FCW. Have something else. Yes.
FCW returns to Decon, yep, ladies and gentlemen.
We know that there will be a cosplay rumble taking place.
Yes. As of the time of recording, again, that is all we know that's happening right now. Yes. But I believe we will be having a few other matches as well throughout the day.
Yep.
What they are, yeah, we don't know.
But
all will be revealed. So, and it's a free show, I believe, isn't it?
You need
to buy your Decon ticket.
There's no additional cost to... That's what I meant.
Now, as you guys know, I do love me a little bit of a shake-up. But I definitely say that there is no bigger shake-up than the Cosplay Rumble at Decon. Because if you have a look last year, you got to see every single Fair City wrestler in a way that you've never, ever seen them before.
That's true.
You got some absolutely incredible moments. You had Shrek pointing at Jesus in the Dundee University Chaplaincy after winning. You had
Shrek's due a title shot.
Shrek is due a title shot.
Shrek, yeah. Like, is your boy Sebastian going to defend his title against
Shrek?
Against Shrek?
Somebody once told me. Nah, I'm not going to hit that joke. Sorry. I mean, maybe. I mean, that would be kind of interesting. But as I said, there's so many moments we had. We got to see that Spider-Man meme in real life.
Yep.
Of two Spider-Men pointing at each other.
Yep.
We got to see Dio stop time and kick everyone square in the dick.
We got to see Bonesaw and Randy Savage,
yes,
side by side.
We got
to see Bane.
Yes.
We got to see Bane.
We got to see Ash Ketchum, right? His actual age in real life.
After he'd been on a bender after winning the Pokemon League.
Yes.
So it genuinely is. Well, I know I'm getting a little bit sentimental for this because this was something that I've wanted to happen for a while. I'm into the sort of things at Decon. I'm into anime and games and movies and all these sort of things, and trying to get in there has been a pet project of mine as well as others.
Not only are we there, you said we're in the chaplaincy. We've now been promoted venue-wise, aren't we?
We have.
We're going to get more people, hopefully, at ringside this time.
Exactly. We started off in the chaplaincy.
Which was a lovely venue, I will say that. I would like to go back there one day, because that was a lovely venue.
You could win the Rumble and point to Jesus.
Yeah, it was a lovely venue for us. I'd love to go back and remember we had everyone at ringside, obviously. Yeah. But imagine if we could get folk up on the balcony as well.
I think we did have some folk on the balcony.
Well, but I think there were, like, ideally meant to be another stall, but well, the rest of it is quite good, so we get a bit. But I mean, like, if we officially just have that area, but book it, Commissioner.
But yeah, so we are going to be up on the green at Dundee Union.
Yeah, just outside. Yeah, just outside the Union, or the wee news agent. Yeah,
I mean, if it pops in.
What?
Oh, come on, we drinks in.
We half time. Yeah.
Just before we go into the ropes.
But yeah. So if you know Dundee. You know the university campus. We're right outside the student union on the wee grassy, but hopefully it's a nice day.
Should be a nice day.
Yeah.
Fingers crossed.
If you want some wrestling before you're wrestling, then come along. Yeah. But I do apologise for interrupting you. We were going to talk about what's happening on Saturday night, weren't we?
And it's no longer Dundee Academy Pro Wrestling as we know it, because we've gotten bigger and better.
Yep.
Not only are we training school, but we've essentially, the powers that be at FCW are now turning that dub essentially into its sort of own promotion then.
Yeah.
We're expanding, we're not just Dundee's wrestling school, we're now Dundee and Angus professional wrestling.
Mm-hmm.
So that's hopefully shows that we're going to get not only shows in Dundee, but hopefully the greater Angus area as well.
Yeah,
so that's a lot to look forward to in the future.
Mm-hmm.
And this is our like first show under this banner. But I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, we've got a good wee card lined up for this night. Should be good.
Should we get this out of the way?
I really think this is a match. Because we'll be sort of
touching on it all night. Freya knows.
Freya disagrees as well.
See, no. I kind of enjoying the ambiance and mise-en-scène that we've got just now.
Well,
so,
do you know what? You relinquished control of this podcast when you walked out, so I'm taking charge and we're talking about this right now.
Okay.
Let's just get it out of the way.
We are getting Patryk Peterski versus Duke.
We are indeed.
We need to settle this in the ring, because as we've touched on already throughout this podcast, we'll not try and tread over too much ground that we've already kind of covered intermittently.
If you can't tell, the tension is quite high between them.
It took a lot of love and respect I have for you to make me feel now the way I feel about you. You know,
so can I ask?
And you know what I mean?
But let me ask.
Yeah?
At what point did all that love and respect fold away?
It wasn't even just one thing. It was months and months of nothing.
Something broke the camel's back. There was a straw there. What was that straw? Tell me.
Well, last month really didn't help either. Because you know how hard I've been working since I walked in the door. You know how hard this man's been working since he walked in the door. He's been here a lot longer than me. And he's been scratching and clawing for an opportunity.
You got your opportunity.
We did, and you mucked it up for us. You did that.
Me?
None of this stuff again.
Okay.
You know what you did. You need to just accept what
you did. Let's go back a bit. So, you're right. I jumped up on the side of the ring.
Mm-hmm.
I had a little conversation with Chris Quinn, and he happened to miss a couple of things that happened.
So for those of you that don't know, Duke got up on the ring, distracted the ref. Kane Douglas has given Tom Atlas a lovely big back body drop.
Yep.
I've caught Tom Atlas in a powerbomb. I wait to plant him into the mat. I turn round.
Sebastian Asher comes in and kicks us both in the crown jewels.
Yeah, boots me in the balls. Just does the same to you and just like is on top of you, like dead weight, stopping you from getting in the ring. Tom Atlas hits his Busaiku knee. 1, 2, 3. That does not happen without you.
You're right. Do you know a little secret, Patryk?
Go on.
Something that I wanted to tell you a little bit earlier.
Is this the definition of insanity you're going to tell us? Because we've heard it quite enough.
No. You know, there was actually a space for you. Among me, Tom, Spike and Sebastian. There was a place for you there.
Yeah, you know me and you knew I wouldn't want to go down that road. I want to do this. What I see is the right way. I don't think what you're doing is right.
And that's the problem, is that you want to do things the right way. Let me tell you something. As much as we've had this planned for quite a while, I tried to do things the right way once. I did. I tried to do everything by the book. I tried to do everything that was expected of me as a wrestler, as a decent human being. And you know what I got for it?
A tag team championship.
Oh, you better take it.
No, that wasn't because of the sticking by the book or anything like that. No. What that got me was my ass kicked. Time and time and time again. Because there has to be a point where you realise that some people expect you to be the bigger person so that they can slink lower and lower and lower. And do you know what happens to those people? Nothing. Nothing. What happened to Redgate after they brought me out and attacked me backstage in Nay Mercy, dragging me out like some sacrificial lamb? What happened to them? Oh, there was nothing. I wanted to test the water with Sebastian's little cheap shot at me with the podcast. You know what happened to him? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. Because there are no repercussions for those who are willing to go further and do what is necessary. Do you know why? Because secretly, each and every one of us wishes we were that person. We wish that we were the person who could do what was necessary in order to win. And I just...
You're wrong. You're wrong. Yeah. I'm not that guy. I know Kairn's not that guy.
No.
I literally cracked Kevin Williams' head open with a chair in front of children. And why haven't I been fired? Tell me why I've not been fired. That's a criminal offence. I should be in prison right now. I should be facing jail time, but I'm not. I'm not, because I know how this industry works and no one can deny that.
Well, maybe that's why I've been put in this match with you. Maybe I am the justice, to sound not too cliched. But that's not why I'm doing it. I'm doing it because I'm here to prove that you can do things the right way. And you can, you don't have to stab people in the back to get somewhere in pro wrestling. I'm going to do what you did. I'm going to play by the rules, as you so dismissive of them or whatever. Again, sorry, I'm trying to get ahead here.
Yeah, you've got this.
Not only am I going to achieve those heights that you did, play the game, you got to a tag team title. We're going to do this one day.
Yep.
And when it inevitably ends, because all title reigns have to end at some point, whether it's this year, next year, the year after that, I'm not going to do what you did at the end of it. I'm going to prove to you that there's a different way to do things. You don't have to keep playing the same game that wrestlers have been playing for, Christ, what, over 100 years now? There's more than one way.
Isn't the idea to improve the business?
Exactly.
Rather than keeping it the same?
Leave it better than when you found it.
Yep.
Don't just keep repeating the same things over and over again.
That's the definition.
I know.
Did you not listen to a single word that I was saying earlier? Why did you invite me on this podcast if you're just gonna like disregard everything that I've said? My entire reason for doing this is to raise this goddamn company up.
That's what you think you're doing.
No.
It's entitled to raise yourself up.
That's exactly what you're doing, man.
You don't even care about the ones you have with you. This is all about you.
What makes you think that?
It's just obvious with the way you act, the way you're talking, the way you're presenting yourself.
The sooner the other three realise that, the better. Speaking of the others.
You really have not listened to a single word I've said. But you know what? That's more just to my advantage. More than anything.
I envy everyone you've never met. I hope you know that.
Speaking of the others, Freya's really.
This is just unbearable.
It's just fine. Let's talk about your boys. We've got two championship matches that night. First one, Spike Tierney.
Mm-hmm.
The biggest villain now, all of a sudden, in the greater Tayside area.
Yeah, that's just a matter of perspective.
Yeah, you're good at that. Taking on his former tag team partner.
Yep.
Which has now made me think, wow, him walking out on Botchko about over a year and a half ago now makes a lot more sense.
Mm.
Just the way he was very dismissive of him at the time, just kind of shoved him off. But I digress.
From what you've been explaining as well, Jake, the timelines kind of add up a bit.
Yeah, the dots are being connected now.
Yep.
So we've got Botchko.
Wouldn't it be funny if that was all just a ruse and Botchko's actually going to join us?
Yeah, but from what you said tonight, you've offered half the roster this. I just think you're havering again. But anyway, couldn't happen twice, could it?
Couldn't happen twice at all, could it? No.
So we've got Flips and Slips implode for the final time, for definite now. Botchko versus Spike for the junior heavyweight title.
Yep.
Botchko's earned this. Spoke about earning your opportunities, climbing ladders. Botchko earned this. Botchko came back at the Rumble last year, nearly won the whole thing. It wasn't for Serena Rose.
Yeah.
And then he beat a former heavyweight champion, Yuen G. Maki.
I also think he had an inclination of helping Yuen.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I think Botchko, again, we spoke about catalyst for change earlier on. Botchko was definitely that for Yuen.
And then, as you said, unfortunately got injured.
Yeah. But a victory over a heavyweight champion, Yuen G. Maki. Duke, I think you would concede this as well. You beat a heavyweight champion, former heavyweight champion, you've got the right to a title match.
You've earned a title match.
Yeah, well, I'm like that. Yeah, I will concede that. I will 100% concede that. I would say that Botchko has definitely earned this shot.
He's earned a shot, Spike.
He's earned a shot, but he's also earned it in a lot more ways as well. Like, I respect Botchko.
Mm-hmm.
I respect him quite a lot. And when him and Spike split up, I could see him, you know, trying to find himself. Because he did doubt himself for a long time.
Mm-hmm. He had a bit of an identity crisis, didn't he?
He did.
Yeah.
Until he realised his place. And his place is in the ring.
Mm-hmm.
I won't deny that, and I don't think either of you two can either.
Absolutely not.
No.
He does deserve to be in that ring. And as I said, he was so, so close to winning the Rumble. And again, he beat Yuen G. Maki.
Mm-hmm.
He beat a former heavyweight championship, and he has earned this spot. Botchko, however, has been out for a couple of months due to an injury. Again, not his fault, and I'm glad that he's made his recovery.
Mm-hmm.
But I think he's coming in with this sort of strong sense of justice as he's heard about all these things that happened. Not seen, heard. Coming in with this house on fire mentality to take down his former tag team partner. Failing to realise the gravity of the situation. And the gravity of the situation is that he is not going up against the Spike Tierney that he knows.
No.
He doesn't. He is not doing that whatsoever. He's going up against a person who showed him a side that he wanted to show him.
Well, nobody knew that side of Spike existed.
Mm.
Spike's already...
Correction, yous didn't know
that side of Spike. Spike's already the best junior heavyweight in Scotland.
Yeah.
And now he's got this new... Well, there's now newly revealed edge, shall we say, to him.
Exactly.
That makes him even more formidable than before.
And that's why he is able to carry that belt that's been carried by the likes of Ken Caden and that other guy. Forget names. As I was saying, like, that's why Spike has that belt. Spike has that belt because he is not one of the best. He is the best junior heavyweight in Scotland. I will put money on that. I would die with those words emblazoned on my grave. I will go to bat and say this, that Spike Tierney is and always will be the best junior heavyweight in Scotland.
we've said it before. What if? That's the beauty of wrestling.
Yeah. Things can easily change.
Things can easily
change. It takes 3 seconds, Duke.
And I mean, I'll admit, if there's one thing that Bochico has always had on his side, it is unpredictability.
Who knows Spike Tierney better than anyone? Better than you. Better than Sebastian. Better than Tom. Bochico. They were tag team partners for a good few years, weren't they?
See? Yeah.
That's a lot of time spent together. That's a lot of time in the gym spent together. That's a lot of time, and again, I go back to it, but it's important. It's a lot of time down the steel, sparring, training with each other.
Knowing each other in and out.
I agree, but I also disagree to a point. I agree that, yes, they have spent so much time together, they've trained together, they've worked together as a team and stuff like that, but Bochico never knew that Spike had this side to him, and very few people did. But if there's one thing that, as I was saying before, that Bochco has on his side, it is unpredictability, which means that Spike has never really known the true Bochco or what he is going to achieve. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm not saying this to have any less faith in Spike. I think Spike is more than capable of walking in this match and walking out with that belt. However, what I am going to say is that Bochco is not going to make things easy. He's not. And it's because of how unpredictable he is, what he can pull out of the bag that makes him the most dangerous. But I'd actually wager that he's one of the most dangerous people that we have in the company. A lot of people look at him and see him, see this clown, see this happy-go-lucky guy that comes out.
But this is it. We know that he's not that. Yeah. We know that he's not that.
Sounds like you're rooting against your own boy.
No.
I think Duke's just giving Bochco his flowers deservedly.
Okay, he does deserve those flowers.
Well, yeah, I'm not denying that.
Because like I just said, we all know how, like, it's not, that's not, like, Bochco, like, has this
mythos.
Yeah, but we know that there's more there.
It's when, it's
a honey trap almost. It's like, I'm just Bochco, I'm a Bochco, the clumsy oaf. He's not, he's more than that.
Oh, fancy on track.
That, he's in that sort of Orange Cassidy area of wrestling. He can suck you in with the mind games. Because, again, Bochco's cleverer than people think.
Yeah.
Especially since he's come back.
It's almost as if he presents what he wants to show people and then have things hidden underneath. It's almost as if some of the things that I'm saying keep circling around and applies to multiple people, and maybe my whole theory about wrestling being a game is actually true, but that's a point that no one's willing to discuss, are we? Because I'm just talking shite, aren't I? No, but I digress. No. I definitely think the Bochco deserves this chance. I definitely think the Bochco could hold that belt someday.
Are you going to stay out of it and let him have a fair crack at the whip?
Are you going to be ringside with your pint getting up and interacting with the ref?
You won't be if, you know, I have my way with him.
Yeah. I mean, leaving a stretcher.
I mean, that's going to be the only way to put me down, but okay. Let's
park that.
Let's park that for just now.
Let's go into some tag team action, guys. You mentioned Redgate.
Yep.
Now, with Redgate being the mysterious bunch that they are, can't say 100% sure who's going to be involved in this match. But if I had to take a punt, I reckon we might see Samuel and Valak in this match representing Redgate. You all saw that sort of creepy, almost like... initiation is the word I'm looking for.
Baptism in fire. It was
at the last Dapdub show. Valak was, you know, sprayed in the face by Samuel's red mist, carted off into the woods somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
I know, Kairn, you're still wondering where this red gate is.
I've never seen a red gate since then. Yeah.
But you know, it looks. And we saw in Valak, he's in red gate now. So I think what a test for him.
To converted over.
He's in there, man. What a way to appease Tommy Cross, I think. For Samuel and Valak to take on an interesting team in Yuen G. Maki and G.D. Wild, the former patriarch of the Redgate.
The former leader, wasn't he?
Okay, That's what we're getting. That's certainly interesting. Also, I want to say on a quick side note, you can say what you want about us and our group. At least everyone joined us voluntarily. We never forced anyone into our group like Redgate has. Or does.
You can confirm there was no blood sacrifices.
I can confirm that
no one's taken to a woods against their will.
Nope. No one's been taken to the woods or anything like that. No one.
You haven't spit in each other's mouths or anything like
that. Nah, that's not really about that. Well, not with the people that I wrestle with. I know what
they're doing. Are you just saying that because you don't want the same outcome as JD Wild?
More saying that because, well, if JD Wild actually respected the people that he was with, he'd still be Redgate Red, wouldn't
he? Well, that's what made his end, wasn't it? For those of you who don't know, he got very... He set over the mark, I think, a year ago. Yeah. Didn't he?
Oh, he...
And Kerrigan, Tommy, and Samuel said, nope.
I'm pretty sure he gave Tommy a like, slap in the face, and Tommy did not like that.
Out of all the people in FCW... that I wouldn't slap in the face. Tommy Cross is number one.
As someone who has received his forearms while lying on the wooden floor of the Tulloch and had my head bounced like a goddamn basketball, I am inclined to agree with you.
Yes. He's a strong boy.
He is a big boy. He is a strong boy. He is an angry boy.
He is an angry boy.
He is a very, very angry boy.
But this is interesting for so many reasons. Like we've just touched on there. Looks like it's going to be the debut of Valak in Redgate, teaming with Samuel for the first time. So, and Samuel was once in Valak's shoes. He was the one that was able to prove himself in Redgate.
Yep.
Samuel's kind of moved up in the ranks, I think. He's going to be that guy now. Saying you're going to have to prove yourself.
Yeah.
If you want to, you're in this.
Samuel's
cult, for lack of a better term.
Valak is the newbie.
He's going to have to prove himself.
Yeah, I mean,
what better way to vanquish their old leader?
But I mean, a trial by fire tends to be a very Redgate approach. I remember the first time that I faced Samuel was when me and Nathan North took on Redgate for the titles.
You won them, didn't you?
And we won them. Yeah. A trial by fire seems to be a very
Redgate thing to do.
A very traditional thing at this point. Yeah. But if anything, that's the best way to separate the wheat from the chaff.
Sink or swim.
Sink or swim, and they're all about that. So. For me, it's... I know that Valak is going to want to prove himself.
He has to.
He has to prove that he has what it takes to be in Redgate. And as you said, there's no better way to do that than to take out the former leader. But again, this is no longer the JD Wild that we knew. This is a homeless guy... from what I can see.
Who's very nearly our champion.
Who's lost his goddamn mind.
Yeah. I don't even think he knows who he is at this moment.
Yeah. Do you think he knows that he nearly won the title from Looking Different a few months ago?
I think he just...
He boots people up the arse with that one odd shoe.
Yeah.
Like, I think that's all he really knows is that there's arses out there to be booted.
Yeah. I mean, we've spoken about wild cards in this podcast. There's not a bigger wild card right now than JD Wild. And that's before you even talk about... Yuji Maki. We've talked about on this podcast before because he's what hasn't already been said about him.
I would go with you and JD Wild purely because of the wild card factor. That's my opinion. But we do have to take into consideration that Valak is a new member of Redgate, so there could be new things up their sleeves that we haven't seen before.
As much as I hate to give them credit for any way, shape or form, I think Valak is going to want this too much and want it too much to be able to give up.
He needs it. And let's be honest, Samuel needs it as well.
I mean,
they need to appease Tommy.
Since Tommy's taken over, I mean, he hasn't been in the ring as much, but he has definitely been there. And even now, you can tell that he is a much more ruthless leader. JD Wild had the downfall of making everything about himself.
Yeah.
He came out, he wanted to appeal to the crowd, he wanted to talk to everyone. Tommy's business. Tommy has always been business.
You've seen when he's out there for Samuel, or he was out there for Eden during her gauntlet match a few months ago. He is very much about
keeping the control.
But also the collective, like Duke was just talking about. Like you said, I think JD did go down that sort of
it's about me
ego trip.
Yeah.
You know.
which ends up being the downfall of a lot of people.
Yep.
So again, another
bit of foreshadowing, maybe for some. Who knows? Let's maybe.
That's kind of what we do in Dab and SCW. We offer up very intriguing matches for our adoring public.
Yes.
And all we can do is speculate with the information that we have.
Yeah.
Should we keep on the tag team train?
Let's go for it.
Prophets of Doom. I've been on a...
And you guys.
Dunny, you start now.
What?
Right, okay. I'm going to attempt to have a bit of fun with you now, Duke.
Okay.
For old time's sake. Kairn has it in his head that Grum... You know, Solomon Grum, you know, the Solomon Grum.
As in, oh God, it's Grum, Solomon
yes,
Grum.
Yes, Solomon Grum and Holden. Kairn's got it in his head that they're not actually that big.
I'm not saying they're not big. They're big.
That's why I said
they're not as big as people are making out, or as how the camera makes them out. Again, it's forced perspective. You seen Lord of the Rings?
Has he seen Lord of the Rings? Come on now.
I don't know. He's lied about a lot, so he could have been lying about that.
So, okay. So, in order to try and explain this a little bit...
He's going to say he's not seen Lord of the Rings.
No. I have seen Lord of the Rings. I understand what you mean about forced perspective, but I think... That going off of that, we have to explain something, that some wrestlers are small and some wrestlers are far away.
I've been in the ring. I understand.
So what's he not getting here?
I don't know. He literally saved me from Solomon Grum in the King of Class Rumble.
If it was that big, how did I get him out?
Close enough to smell him.
I mean,
and you still maintain that he's not that big. How big do you think he is?
The human body can do many, many incredible things when it's under a lot of stress. So I can understand how you might be able to throw out somebody like Solomon Grum and think, he's not that big. I heard a story about, like, old dirty bastard saw a kid get, like, trapped under a car, and he used all his crack strength to, like, lift the car.
Kairn's got that strength.
Yeah.
Kairn's got that strength.
Maybe you're just selling yourself short.
Maybe. Yeah. It's first perspective. I stand by that.
Okay.
No, I've stood next to both Holden and Solomon Grum, and I can say that they are two pretty goddamn big dudes.
So anyway, they've been on a sort of tear against Randy Valentine in recent months. Mm-hmm. Last Dab show, went to a no contest, because they just beat the crap out of each other on the outside of the ring. Last FCW Empire show, Holden got surprised, I think, by Randy, because Randy took out Solomon Grum with chloroform.
Okay.
Yeah. And then.
How much chloroform did he need? Like 5 liters?
It was the whole bottle, man. Like the whole bottle was gone.
Nah, it's not that big.
Anyway.
I'd be taking him out with like horse tranquilizers, just to be safe.
But even then, you think, well, again, hold him, because he is that big. In there against even a man with all his experience as Retro Randy. You think, well, Holden would probably still have this one as well. But I think Grum not being taken out of the equation definitely sort of. Knocked Holden a bit, like, oh, this isn't what we planned.
Through Randy's game a bit.
Like, Randy was able to, well, partly taking Grum out, he was able to use all that experience and cunning and veteran know-how, ends up getting a win on Holden. But, Prophets of Doom do what they do after the match, and they squashed Randy like a basketball.
Yes.
Between their hands, but it was between their bodies, it was horrible.
Why'd you pick basketball for that?
I don't know. I was a scrum. Watermelon, maybe? What do you squash?
I mean, I would... squash the skulls of my enemies, but in failing that, grape. Squash like a grape.
There you go. So Randy is sick of this 2-on-1, and he's
like a bug.
He wants to.
Yeah,
I'm sorry.
No. There's so many.
There's so much tension going on. You've got a lot in your mind. I understand.
Yeah, I understand.
So we've got a return on our hands.
Ooh.
He's been hinting on who it is, but. I think we know who it is, but let's not jump the gun.
I think I've just clicked on your.
We'll speak about it after. Let's not jump the gun. Let's just turn up and find out. Randy said in his promo after that. Let's just wait.
Is it? I think it
might be. Whoa. Might have to have a word with me.
Okay.
Anyway, but we'll leave that.
I think
Randy will reveal all near the time.
Okay.
So we got two
These
more.
There better not be any filthy lies.
No. Two more matches, I think, to talk about from what I can see here. Before we talk about the main event, let's talk about Pretty Boy Sam again.
Ooh.
He's got a busy boy that weekend, isn't he? Yeah. Not only is he making his singles debut in SCW, he's doing the same for Dundee and Angus Pro.
Oof.
Turned up in the King of Class Rumble at the last show, but again, this is his first singles match.
Mm-hmm.
He is taking on everyone's most annoying wrestler, if you want. The guy that we put number one, Body Guy Brandon.
Ugh, happy guy.
Aye.
Ugh. Well, Sam's got us in the bag. I don't know what else she expected me to say, yes.
But there's more.
Oh.
We have a special guest enforcer for this match. And it is Body Guy Brandon's sort of nemesis now.
Oh.
Jaden Riley, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh.
Jaden Riley's in the house.
I'm not going to make sure
order is kept.
I'm not going to lie, I quite like Jaden. He's a...
Was there a spot open for Jaden at one point, was there?
Maybe in a couple of years. Yeah. Maybe in a couple of
years. Is he in the youth team?
he's in the young team.
Okay.
Well, all I've got to say now is I hope Body Guy Brandon has all his affairs in order, because I don't think he's getting out of this one. With Jaden there as well?
Yeah.
Aye, it's a dead man. That's that is.
I think there's a big boot coming his way. A discus big boot that Sam likes to use.
Yes. Yeah.
I mean, I'll be 100% honest, nothing would bring me greater joy than seeing Body Guy Brandon get his ass kicked. That's a guy I've got absolutely no time for, would never associate with in my life. Absolutely no time for him. And as we were saying before about Pretty Boy Sam, he has that match the night before.
That's the thing, he will have come off a hell of a test.
Yeah.
Is that direct? So that could make or break him the next day. Even if whether he's victorious or not, he might just be beaten up too much.
But
that might give Body Guy Brandon an advantage. Or does Sam take the lessons he's learned the night before and use them against Body Guy Brandon?
Yeah.
Sam does seem like the kind of guy that would, regardless of the outcome, would be more scented by it, I believe the term is. If he wins, he knows what he's capable of. So he can go into that match with confidence and take out Body Guy Brandon. If he loses, he's lost to one of the best in the country.
There's a phrase, you either win or you learn.
Yeah.
I think that's kind of what you're getting at.
Yeah, that's exactly
the position he's in.
Yeah.
And I believe that with this being the start of his career at Fair City Wrestling, again, even if he loses his first match, again, he's losing to one of the greatest guys out there, but that just gives him even more motivation.
And that'll make him better for facing Brandon.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah.
And with Jaden there as well.
Yeah. Jaden will make sure there's no nonsense.
No nonsense.
Jaden gets his hand on him and gives him a slam.
Yeah. You saw what happened last time.
Yeah.
Even I wouldn't take one of those.
Yeah, no.
Maybe Brandon will. Maybe.
Snap.
Fancy. Yeah, maybe. Yeah. Maybe he'll just like realise that he's not sexy and he knows it.
Yeah.
I'd love to see Jaden get in there with him.
Just batter him. I think we'll see it soon enough.
Hope so.
I mean, I can definitely see it in maybe in some kind of future. So, but for now, let's
keep going, Jim. It's what we want to happen.
Yeah.
For now, we'll see how.
See how he does as enforcer.
Yeah.
We'll see how Brandon and Pretty Boy get on.
Yeah.
Right, lads. We've had a long, arduous journey.
Yes.
But we are here at the main event of the weekend. Before WrestleMania starts, all of this wrestling, by the way. Three shows we're putting on for you. And then you get to watch WrestleMania.
Yep, exactly.
Don't say we're not good to you.
I know.
And if you consider the pricing as well, it's a pretty good value package.
And you're cheaper if you order in advance as well, for the SCW show, I believe. I think it's a wee bit cheaper if you order online.
So, yep, so that is...
It's £10 rather than £12.
I believe that it's going to be slightly cheaper.
And
so
the Queen's Hotels, as always, is £5 for Dundee Angus Pro.
So potentially, a whole weekend of quality wrestling, probably the best wrestling you're going to get in Scotland, for £15. £15, that's a steal.
It's a bargain.
Absolute steal.
And then for the cost of a decon ticket, which, forgive me, I don't know.
I can't remember, I believe it's about between £10 and £15.
So you could pay that, you get a whole Comic-Con convention, essentially, is what it is.
And it's a good Comic-Con. Yeah. There's a lot of great people.
And you get a wrestling show.
I do actually believe at DCon, one of our merch people, Shan, is going to be setting up for DCon as well.
Can we give Shan flowers? We've given people in SCW flowers in the past, such as Sarah, wonderful camera person and blogger online.
Yes.
Shan is somebody else that deserves a lot of love.
Yes.
Yeah, The company would not run without her.
To be fair, all of the merch team.
Absolutely.
Like, you've got Sean, you've got Dawn,
yep.
you've got Jem.
Yep.
Again, let's be real. They're the reason we're getting paid.
Absolutely.
They're the reason that we're making money.
Yep.
They're the reason that we are able to do this month after month.
Yeah. So yeah, thank you all.
Yes.
I know that we are forever in your debt for the work that you do for us. Thank you. So on that nice note, shall we talk about our main event of the Dap Dub show?
Yes. Main event of the weekend.
Yes. We've touched on it earlier on, so we don't need to go totally into the backstory again, because we've kind of, it's been the thread of this whole episode.
Yep.
And it's all leading to this. J. Robin versus Sebastian Asher for the Dundee and Angus Pro Wrestling Championship.
Two ass kickings in 2 days. It's beautiful, isn't it? Fair City Wrestling giving you the opportunities that you don't get anywhere else.
We've touched on it again. Jay has been the sort of the nearly man almost. It's a tag that you won't want, but...
But he is the nearly man.
It's become like almost like the glorious failure.
Yeah.
Like the Scottish national football team of yesteryear. Nearly, but not quite. Play really well, wrestle really well, but you just can't get over the line. You can't win the big one. He's been in there against main event talent, like ADM. He's been in there with the FCW champion, Dickie Divers. He was in there with the junior heavyweight champion, Spike Tierney. He came so close 3 times now in the last few months, but he's not got the win. And he's got this, what I think is definitely going to be a final shot at glory before he has to go to the back of the line. I'm not...
No, but you're right.
Yeah.
You're right.
This is it now. You'll have seen in the build up to this, I've been trying my best to get through to him, like I tried to get through to you. Similarly to yourself, he's not been given really anything back. But he's got to do it, man. He's got to do it. Because if he doesn't, then where does J. Robin go from here? If he doesn't win the championship.
He goes back to the back of the queue. That's
back
where he
to
goes.
The pecking order.
Yeah.
Back to the pecking order.
I don't know what that'll do to him, but he's got to do everything in his power to not let that happen. And again, I hope you guys will stay out of it, because if Sebastian Asher is the great champion that you've been presenting him as, then he should be able to beat J. Robin, the guy that can't win the big one.
You're right. He should definitely be able.
So let him go and do it. Let him go and prove that he is a champion. He's had enough disputes with his title reigns in the past. He's had enough asterisks beside them. Self-proclaimed this and won it with interference that. Let him go out and prove it in the middle of the ring. If he really is God's gift to professional wrestling, he can beat J. Robin, can't he?
You're right, he can beat J. Robin. But here's the thing that, circling back to what I was saying at the start, Jay is someone who has tried very hard. He has. He's tried very hard and he has failed. And there is nothing wrong with that. We all fail. We all fall down so that we can pick ourselves up again and keep going forward. The thing that's always gotten me though is that failure usually puts you back, maybe not to square one, but it puts you back a few steps. All it's done for him is just given him more opportunities and more opportunities and more opportunities and more opportunities. Now, I've got to ask yourselves, answer honestly, do you think that's fair? Answer with your whole heart.
I mean, you've got to agree with his logic. Might not agree with his methodology, but his logic's there.
If I lost every single match that I had, would you say that I'm championship material?
Remember why Jay's getting this shot. Because the way the last shot ended. You know that.
I know that.
You know that's why he's getting this shot.
I know.
But that's why I think it will be his last shot. Because this is the, you know, he got screwed out of that last championship match. So.
And that's the thing. That's why for all intents and purposes, we will leave it be. We'll let him go in, get his chance. If anything, the whole thing that happened with the junior heavyweight, that was to send a message.
Well, I hope you're telling the truth, but as you've been making it very clear throughout this podcast, you're not a man to be trusted. So it doesn't really matter what you say. We'll just need to wait and see.
But as I was saying, let's go back to looking at the facts here. Again, he has failed time and time again. So as you're right, he does need to win this.
Mm-hmm.
He does. He has to show that he has everything that it takes to be able to get that belt. And again, last month aside, he could probably do it. He could. And if he does, then fair. I'll congratulate him. As you say, all title reigns must come to an end at some point. Nothing lasts forever. Entropy engulfs the universe, blah, 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 blah. But I want people to also acknowledge why we did what we did. I want people to acknowledge that the reason that he's getting that chance is a reason that other people haven't been afforded. It's other people have been screwed out of matches. Other people have been screwed out of getting their titles. They don't get rewarded with more title shots, do they?
You're right. Again, he's speaking logical. I know that it's quite hard when he is speaking some sense.
Well, you don't have to agree with any of the things that I've done. Hell, if I could do, as I said before, if I could do this all peacefully, I would. If we could restore order to Fair City Wrestling, we would. But we can't. And that is the point that I've been trying to drive home for the entirety of this podcast. In order for things to be right again, sometimes there's a bit of upheaval. And don't get me wrong, there's still going to be some upheaval if J. Robin wins. I'm not saying that in a threat of violence way. You can trust me or not. It's your choices. There will still be some upheaval. There will be a new status quo. There will be new goal lines drawn and set in the sand. But I want everyone to acknowledge that we at least had a point to what we've been doing. Whether we win or whether we lose.
I'll tell you right now, I agree with what you're saying there. Right? But at what cost? At ruining your friendship? At destroying relationships you've built up over the past few years, just tarnishing and turning them away? I get there's things have to be changed. But at what cost? At ruining everything, everyone you knew and you built friendships with?
Sometimes we have to look at the bigger picture when it comes to these things. And you're right. This has cost me friendships. This has cost me a lot of trust. And I understand that it's probably going to take a long time before I get that back with anyone. But when you're working towards something that's greater than yourself, sometimes you have to look at what you're willing to give up to achieve that. And that's what I'm doing. I will bear the crosses that I carry. I will accept the things that I've done. My empire of dirt, if you will. But I don't want anyone to ever think that there was no reason behind this. That it was just me being selfish. That it was just me trying to put myself first and put everyone else last.
I can't listen to this anymore.
No, Patty.
Ah, come on, Pat.
Okay,
what's up?
You're up.
No, what's up?
I can't listen to this anymore.
What, you're annoyed that I've maybe got a point and you just don't want to admit it? Kairn admitted it.
We can see tensions are getting pretty high here, folks. I think we may need to end that one here.
Shame. Such a shame.
Well, heated debates are always quite the topic to talk about, but it goes a bit far when friendships are getting tarnished here by it. because I think the best thing to do is maybe end this here.
Maybe a yeah. Might be a good idea before any other friendships get ruined.
Yeah, let's do that.
Hey, well, thank you for having me along, and thank you for introducing me to your cute little donkey. Who's a good girl? Who's a good girl?
Well, thank you for listening. I know it's not been the most positive one this time, but I hope you've enjoyed it. Catch you later.